So thank you for the invitation. And these are my disclosures. And I would start with a slide you have seen many times during these and previous meetings, the same concept that Stephanie has just shown you. So the fact that by genetically engineering hematopoietic stem and progenitor cells and transplanting these cells back into conditioned recipients, we have the ability to reconstitute different populations in peripheral blood and tissues. And this can have therapeutic potential for a variety of conditions. I think what is very relevant for our discussion today is the fact that this process of transplantation allows also to reconstitute and to generate a population of microglia functionally equivalent cells into the CNS. And this could be of great relevance for neurometabolic and neurodegenerative conditions. And the reasons for this therapeutic relevance are multiple. First of all, these cells have the ability upon engraftment into the CNS to modulate and reduce tissue damage and neuroinflammation because of the features of these cells. They can restore scavenging and homeostatic functions, replacing metabolically incompetent microglia cells. And they can also become a reservoir for therapeutic molecules that could be in this way delivered to the central nervous system. And in the case of lysosomal disorders, these molecules could be lysosomal enzymes. This latter point could be of great relevance in the setting of gene therapy because, as we have discussed many times in the past, gene transfer could allow us to potentiate and to enhance this secretory function of hematopoietic stem cell-derived microglia populations in the CNS. This discussion and this therapeutic opportunity has been explored in animal models first and then in humans since several years. And I think in the literature we have a number of evidences of its relevance and of its role in curing patients, not only mice. And we have in this case two of the examples. One comes from my personal experience. And I think these trials applied, for example, to children affected by metachromatic leukodystrophy or adrenal leukodystrophies, so conditions that are metabolic storage diseases, have clearly shown that genetically engineering hematopoietic stem cell transplantation can allow to achieve a therapeutic benefit in these patients thanks to robust protein delivery to the CNS. The extent of benefit has been remarkable, and based on that positive experience, new trials are upcoming and are ongoing in new indications, mimicking that kind of concept. But for those of you who have read the literature and had the chance to explore in more detail these findings, it's also clear that the benefit has been very remarkable in every patient who had been treated early, in an early stage of the disease, either pre-symptomatic or at the beginning of clinical manifestations. Benefit has been suboptimal whenever the disease was already advanced and present in these children. So clearly, we have an unmet medical need here, and we need to go back to the bench from the bedside and try to optimize our gene therapy approaches based on hematopoietic stem cells in order to provide a therapeutic opportunity also to these patients. And this is what we did in the lab, and we went back to my studies, to very simple transplantation studies, in order to address two key points that, in my opinion, are extremely relevant in order to address our need of fostering the efficacy of this approach into the CNS. One is the timing of cell engraftment into the brain, and the other one, the way we engineer the cells that we want to transplant. As far as the first point is concerned, obviously, if you want to anticipate timing of engraftment and foster and favor engraftment, we need to understand how this engraftment of new transplant-derived cells happens in the brain. And we address this point, as many other laboratories, by exploiting very simple transplantation tools. And these transplantation tools have told us something that was quite unexpected. For those of you who have read literature in this field, I think the standard modality by which this cell engraftment in the brain would happen is migration of gene-corrected transplant-derived monocytes from the peripheral blood into the CNS. According to our data, in reality, this is not what happens. What we think happens is that a fraction of the transplanted hematopoietic stem cells, very shortly after infusion, would home into the brain, engraft locally, and generate a progeny of myeloid cells that would progressively differentiate up to becoming functionally equivalent to microglia. If this is true, this is a paradigm very similar to what we apply to regular transplantation in the hematopoietic system. And in that setting, the key element in order to achieve engraftment of the transplanted cells is to provide to the patients a proper conditioning. And we think this is the same also for the CNS. And we have demonstrated a few years ago that indeed, in order to achieve robust engraftment of transplant-derived microglia-like cells in the brain, we need to provide to patients and mice a proper conditioning that is able to selectively ablate microglia-like precursors in the brain and provide space and opportunity from the transplant-derived HSC to engraft locally and generate a progeny. Obviously, the next step, this can be done currently with conventional chemotherapies like busulfan and alkylating agents. The next step and the goal of the research we have in the lab is to identify these microglia progenitors, which is something that many others are trying to do, in order to design conditioning regimens specifically tailored to ablate these populations. But unfortunately, we are not yet there. So how else can we improve our engraftment meanwhile? We think that we can improve that by working on the route by which we deliver the hematopoietic stem cells to mice and patients. And in particular, as I told you, that reconstitution of this microglia population relies on early engraftment, early homing and engraftment of HSCs into the brain. We thought that we could have made the process easier, and so we decided to transplant the HSCs directly into the brain, and in particular to deliver them into brain lateral ventricles. And the results was quite impressive, because what we have observed by doing this transplantation and differentially labeling cells transplanted in the brain in the lateral ventricles and cells transplanted IV was that the combinatorial transplant was dramatically enhancing the engraftment of transplant-derived cells in the CNS and increasing the extent of transplant-derived progeny we were seeing into the brain. And this was obtained by combining the ICV, intracerebroventricular delivery of HSCs, with different populations injected IV to rescue animals from lethal conditioning. The combined delivery of stem cells intravenously and in the lateral ventricles did not only have a quantitative advantage in the engraftment of transplant-derived cells in the brain, but also a qualitative advantage, because the cells derive from the HSCs injected in the ventricles that you see in blue in the graph on your right were not only more but also more differentiated and more similar to microglia as far as we look at their morphological features by quantitative assessments. So the comparison between the dark blue lane with the other two lanes, so comparing progeny of intraventricularly delivered HSCs with progeny of intravenously deliver HSC, clearly shows an advantage in terms of maturation and differentiation of the former. And this was true also in terms of gene expression. The ICV cell progeny is expressing at higher levels microglial associated genes and at lower levels early macrophages gene in the CNS. So this obviously opened up the opportunity for us to test whether this increased engraftment and more rapid maturation towards microgliosis of ICV deliver cells could have therapeutic relevance. And we decided to test this potential of increased benefit in the animal model of one neurodegenerative prototypical lysosomal storage disorder. In particular, we worked on infantile neuronal ceroidal hypofuscinosis, which is a very rare, very severe lysosomal disorder caused to the deficient activity of the lysosomal enzyme PPT1. It is mostly characterized by CNS involvement, but other tissues could be involved, including the peripheral nervous system and the muscles. And it has a very good animal model, so it was relatively easy for us to go into the model and to test the efficacy of HSC gene therapy using a lentiviral vector encoding for PPT1 and using this vector to transduce HSCs derived from the defective mice. And in this setting, we decided to compare the traditional gene therapy approach that you see with the blue line, gene-corrected HSCs infused intravenously into preconditioned enzymatically deficient recipients, with the combinatorial approach I mentioned before. So animals that were pretreated with busulfan and received the transduced cells both intravenously and in the brain lateral ventricles. And as you can see, the combined delivery of the gene-corrected stem cells improve therapeutic efficacy associated to gene therapy. So gene therapy per se, the traditional approach, improves the survival of the transplanted mice and improve their behavior. In this case, we are looking at rotarod performance, but the combined transplantation further improve survival and increase the therapeutic benefit associated to this approach. And the reason for this improved benefit is basically a greater engraftment of transplant-derived cells into the CNS that we measure by vector copy number on the brain tissue, and because of increased enzyme delivery into the brain, again, by the transplant-derived cells, always comparing the green dots with the blue dots, the combined delivery versus the single intravenous delivery. So these data are pretty compelling for us and are leading us towards a first-in-human clinical application of this approach that would be hopefully upcoming in the near future. But we also had another question, and we wonder whether the exclusive delivery of HSCs into the brain would be sufficient to rescue the pathology or not and could have therapeutic significance. And so we challenged the same model with this concept, and we delivered gene-corrected HSCs only in the brain lateral ventricles and provided unmanipulated backup PPT1 defective cells as a rescue from lethality of busulfan to the recipient animals. And as you can see, delivery of the gene-corrected cells only in the brain achieved the same extent of benefit of the intravenous delivery of the same population. So if we deliver cells only in the brain, we can in any case achieve rescue of the pathology, improve the survival, and improve the phenotype of the mice that clearly have other manifestations, like in the PNS, that cannot be corrected by the approach, but in any case do benefit. So we reason that this kind of approach, which is obviously CNS exclusive because the cells do not get out of the CNS when they are transplanted there, could benefit other conditions in which the CNS is the only affected tissue. And so we wonder whether this approach could be of relevance for treating disorders that have a number of common mechanisms shared with lysosomal diseases, such as adult neurodegenerative conditions that, as you know, have central processes in common with LSDs, such as microglial activation, oxidative stress, and neurodegeneration. So we thought that our approach, allowing us to generate new microglia that could be endowed with novel properties for protein secretion or modulation of the local neuroinflammatory compartment, could become a relevant therapeutic tool in those settings. And so we decided to test our approach by testing a number of relevant genes in animal models of neurodegenerative diseases. And I'm just showing you a prototypical example of the data we are collecting in the laboratory that is in the setting of an Alzheimer's disease animal model, in which we have basically applied the same HSC gene therapy directed to the lateral ventricles using a gene that is modulating the function of microglia cells in the sense of inducing some modulation of the neuroinflammation that happens in the Alzheimer's disease, and we obtain, again, remarkable therapeutic benefit, a rescue of the pathology and of the abnormalities associated to the disease along its course. So clearly for us this is of great relevance because it tells us that HSC gene therapy could be a relevant therapeutic tool for another totally unexpected area of neurodegenerative disorders, for which obviously the optimization we are working on could be of even greater relevance. And so again, how can we further anticipate our engraftment, and how can we further foster the efficacy of our therapies in the CNS? We have additional alternative approaches. For example, we can further modify the cells to be transplanted. I think that those of you who have followed this meeting, you have heard about how many factors can be manipulated in hematopoietic stem cells in order to favor and foster their homing to hematopoietic niches, their engraftment in the hematopoietic system, and their differentiation. Well, it could be similarly also for the brain. For example, we have identified a factor that I cannot yet disclose, that for example, in a setting of haploinsufficiencies, favors the engraftment of HSCs into the brain of preconditioned animals and their differentiation towards microgliosis. In this case, you are looking at the composition of the brain myeloid populations reconstituted upon transplantation in a competitive setting of wild-type hematopoietic stem and progenitor cells and cells that are haploinsufficient for this factor. And as you can see, the latter prevail over the wild-type cells in the reconstitution process within the brain compartment of recipients. And again, these cells, which are haploinsufficient, are also more mature than the progeny of wild-type hematopoietic stem cells in the same combined transplantation setting. So this is just an example to tell you that there's a lot we can do in order to favor and foster these processes and enhance the therapeutic potential associated to these conditions. The latter point I want to make is that up to now we have been mostly thinking about treating the neurometabolic conditions and possibly also other conditions, but just exploiting these the transplant-derived cells for the delivery of lysosomal enzymes. And this obviously could be effective, as we have seen, and could prevent many of the damages associated to the brain disease in these settings. But whenever we approach an advanced patient, probably just rescue of enzyme activity cannot arrest the progression of a disease in which many other processes have taken place, such as I mentioned, neuroinflammation, oxidative stress, and neurodegeneration. So probably, if we want to address the complexity of advanced disease, we need to take into consideration all of these factors, and we need combined strategies that could allow us to address all of these multiple and equally relevant pathways that are damaging the brain of the patients. And so I think a key effort that we have to do in order to optimize these kind of therapies is to identify molecules that could allow us to address all this. And we have been very lucky because we have found one of these potential candidates, and it was identified in the context of a natural history study, very similar to the one that Stephanie was mentioning before. So a study in which we followed for more than 10 years a huge number of patients affected by metachromatic leukodystrophy before being able to start the clinical trial. And in that study, we have identified in this family of proteins called metallothionein, a marker associated to disease progression. And in particular, metallothionein, they play a critical role in the response of the nervous tissue to damage. They are produced by astrocytes in order to protect neurons from toxic compounds, mostly iron and other metals. But in our case, probably they are produced in order to protect neurons from storage material. Interestingly, these same molecules were found to be overexpressed also in the brain of patients affected by a variety of other lysosomal disorders, and later on we understood that they are overexpressed also in the brain of patients affected by Alzheimer's disease, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, neurodegenerative conditions. So they are really a marker and a reactive marker to brain damage. Interestingly enough, when we monitored this protein in the peripheral blood of patients affected by metachromatic leukodystrophy and receiving treatment by gene therapy and benefiting from their treatment, we saw that the metallothionein returned to normal levels. So they are also a dynamic marker, and they are no longer present in the peripheral blood and tissue of patients whenever the disease has halted. So we thought that this mechanism of self-defense of the brain could be exploited for therapeutic purposes, and we could help the brain to heal and to rescue from the pathology by further increasing the levels of metallothionein. And this is what we did in a very simplistic manner. We crossed metallothionein overexpressing mice with animal models of lysosomal disorders. So we generated transgenic animals in which the lysosomal disease defect was associated to metallothionein above normal expression. And just this increase in metallothionein expression was able to prolong the life expectancy of the mice and attenuate their phenotype. Obviously, we did not expect much because we were not compensating for the enzymatic defect, but just the addition of this factor was enough to provide some extent of benefit, and in particular, the benefit was due to the ability of metallothionein to protect neurons from degeneration, for example, Purkinje cells, and thanks to the ability of this protein to modulate neuroinflammation, to skew the phenotype of activated microglia towards neuroprotective cells, and reduce the overall oxidative stress burden in the tissues. So we really think this could be a powerful way to go. So to combine our standard protein delivery strategy with alternative and additional tools that could allow us to modulate multiple components of the neurodegeneration taking place in LSD patients and in patients affected by adult onset neurodegenerative conditions. And we really think this could be another key to help our symptomatic patients getting relief from their disease. I think for sake of time, I will close here. I will skip this little part that was related to the use of alternative promoters for expressing our therapeutic genes. I would just conclude telling you that really I think is key for us at this stage when we had initial proof of concept of benefit of these approaches to really work on optimization tools and on opportunities that could allow us to address symptomatic disease and additional disorders, sharing with LSDs therapeutic mechanism and potential for treatment. I will close here by acknowledging the contributors to this work from my lab and from the many collaborators and the funding support. Thank you.
So with this inter-CNS delivery, Alessandra, what's the migration of the cells? So if you inject, let's say, left ventricle, do they spread throughout the brain in the mouse?
Yes, they do spread. And what is very interesting, our data suggests that they home in regions that are shared with neuroprogenitors, and they follow in the migration of their progeny the trajectories of neuroprogenitors' progeny. So they go along the rostral migratory stream, and from there they spread throughout the brain parenchyma. We are also challenging the system by transplanting cells in the intrathecal space, and also from there you would have a migration that is slightly differential, but in any case quite robust.
So they can cross from the left to the right brain?
Yeah.
Okay. What about larger animals?
We haven't tried yet.
Hi, very nice talk. I have two questions. So how old are the mice when you do the injection, like the CNS injection?
They are young adult, 2 months old.
2 months old. And after how long do you observe microglia cells after the
So we are used to, we have done a lot of kinetic studies, and as far as 15 days post-transplant, you start to see a progeny, and the progeny would increase in time, and usually you plateau between 3 and 6 months post-transplant.
Thank you.
That was a great story, Alessandra. In fact, the whole concept of delivery of essentially microglia to the CNS for treatment, I think, is very impressive. I wanted to ask you specifically for ICV delivery, could you use completely different conditioning? Actually, do you need conditioning? Is there a room for play there?
Yeah, you definitely need conditioning because the concept remains. You need to empty niches in order to allow the HSCs to engraft. At the moment, we use the usual conditioning, so busulfan, that in our experience is the best choice. But as I said, we and many others are intensively working to identify microglia progenitors, or in any case, those populations whose functional ablation is instrumental for engraftment, in order to possibly develop alternative and less toxic conditioning regimens.
Thank you very much.